we let the patrons know again? I forget.
I don't know.
All right, well, let's get live first and then worry about it.
Okay,
oh, it should, there should be a link there, on the page.
Yeah, there's a button at the bottom that says links.
Right, so that can get posted in Patreon?
Probably. There's an event page. Is that what I should send them?
Yeah, sure.
Hold on, let me check the YouTube. There's a YouTube link as well. Yeah, I like that. That's good art.
Thank you. Man, I'm going to miss this salsa.
And that's it.
That's about it.
I'm going to miss Brooklyn Brewery beer also. Probably don't get that down there. But that's okay. I'll be living within walking distance of a brewery, so it's all good.
Probably of about three of them.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm checking the YouTube. It's loading. Forever. Yeah, okay, it's got a picture. So whatever.
All right, let me draw some more. Tell me if it like updates itself properly or...
Probably a little bit behind.
Well, yeah. So this is concept art for my new swim team anime that I'm going to do.
Great. I like it.
Now you're really into it, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm. Thought it was a dumb idea before, but now I like it.
Well, the amazing thing is he's got a bunch of dicks.
Well, that cuts down on the number of characters you have to draw.
Mm-hmm. It's hard to draw the mouse. In fact, he has no legs. He has dicks for legs.
Mm-hmm. Good thinking.
Mm-hmm.
All right, I'm going to put this. Oh, my God.
Let me erase that.
Yeah, it still got recorded in broadcast.
Okay.
I'm going to Patreon and I'm getting people in here. And you're eating chips.
I'll mute myself.
I should probably be presenting.
Oh, yeah. Aren't you?
Where's that? The Q&A. There it is. We load the Q&A app. This feature is disabled. Maybe you have to load the Q&A app. Do you have that one?
I should.
And or the control.
It just says this feature is disabled.
Yeah, I got that too. And weird.
There's no... anything. There's no like option. There's no click.
Hmm. I also can't present, apparently. I can turn it on or off, and that's it. I guess because it's not my hangout, I don't get to control that.
I guess. I mean, I saw you
art. That's true. Yeah, I guess since you're the one recording, as long as you have me clicked so you're viewing me and not other stuff, that'll work. All right. How do we tell if there are actually people?
I don't know.
It should tell you somewhere how many people are viewing. Maybe it's back on the actual web page.
Oh, it says right here one viewer, which is you or me.
No, we're not viewers. We're...
Well, it's been here since the beginning, since before.
Oh, okay, then it is. That's... Now for your enjoyment, I will eat a taco.
What kind of taco?
If I can actually coax the taco up out of the takeout tray. Oh yeah, lime juice in the paper cuts. Awesome.
Well done.
Feels great. I love it. Mmm. That's a good taco.
Sounds good.
Oh, can you hear me chewing?
Yeah.
Well, I can't reach the mute button.
Oh, I don't care. I feel like I've seen some of this art before.
Yeah, you know, I like to cut corners. There.
So far, no one is saying it's not working.
Are people in here?
Are we alone? All
right, well. And can you turn on the Q&A app at all? See, they need to go to the event page, not the YouTube page, if they want to ask questions.
Yeah, I have went to the event page.
Okay, but you can't turn on the Q&A app?
No, if I click on it, it just tells me this feature is disabled.
I wonder how we re-enable it.
Who knows, because there's literally nothing else I can do.
Yes. Good job, Google, once again. I'm in a moderated call. All right, can't turn that on. Can turn that on.
What have you done?
Oh. Well, I guess we could just use the regular chat then if the Q&A thing isn't going to.
Yeah, I've got it up and nobody's in there, so who knows what's happening?
I think that's enough rocks.
Only draw the nose.
That's all he needs.
Mm-hmm. Just a floating, angry nose. Oh, wait. Crap, we've got viewers.
Uh-oh.
Now they know about my nose fetish.
But can they ask questions?
Oh, and we have outside confirmation that whatever it is we're doing is working.
Yes.
Well, that was fun. Good night.
Was our hour up?
It felt like so many hours.
Yeah, I sometimes wonder if Google goes out of its way to be difficult and buggy as possible. And really, it's like living in a world of no choices. I've either got Apple telling me what buttons to push when and how, or Google, and like they both are terrible.
Yeah, and they don't like each other, so their products don't get along.
Mm-hmm.
Wonderful.
It's the best.
But I finally figured out what was wrong. I had to do some sort of double ultra secret special verification with my phone.
Of course. Of course. That makes total sense. Once we get enough folks and you can determine what that number is, see if they want me to draw anything specifically. Otherwise, I'll just keep working on this.
Son, you are not paid to draw crap that other people talk about.
I thought that was exactly what I got paid to do.
Well, no, other people than me.
Oh. I have to keep mentally reminding myself that no one else can hear my music, so I can't sing along because that would be weird.
No, you really, really should.
Especially since I'm on a Tom Waits marathon at the moment. So.
Yeah, right. With you, I know exactly what it is, and it's Raining Men.
Mm-hmm. Oh, wow. I just had a weird flashback to Web 1.0. Huh?
I said, I knew it.
No, one of the first videos I ever saw on the internet, like CGI, was like this weird little alien sitting on a bar stool. and singing It's Raining Men, but then like a piano or an asteroid falls on its head, like a verse or so in. And it was amazing because it was 1997. Tangent. Oh man, so the reason Dren and I were both out till 1 o'clock in the morning.
Oh good.
Yeah. So once a month or so we do man night.
What you two get up to, it's none of my business.
Mostly we play Warhammer, you know. You wish it was your business.
I do. I would like to play Warhammer.
But it's like Jeff our letterer, Frankie, who is in no way associated with the comic, Fred Van Lent, another comic book guy, Jeff UK, and then kind of a rotating cast of other people, but so this is the last one that Jeff Powell was going to be at because he is moving to New Orleans on Sunday. So thank God for once we actually got together on my island so I didn't have to go to Brooklyn. But I come out from – we were at one brewery, and a little unbeknownst to us, there was like entertainment programming for that night, but yeah, none of it was entertaining.
Yeah, Frankie warned me that you guys got kicked out or something.
We didn't get kicked out. We were just like – for our own sanity, we had to leave. First, there was a live podcast from the brewery. The podcast changes its location all the time.
Oh, okay.
And it's like called like the Super Adventure Podcast or something like that. I don't know. It was pretty
Thrilling
terrible.
Adventure Hour?
Huh?
Thrilling Adventure Hour?
No.
Okay, I was going to say. You're on the wrong coast.
Yeah. No, I don't remember what it was called. I couldn't understand because the acoustics, because it's a brewery, are terrible. Right. So you couldn't actually understand anything the guys were saying. It was just like this really loud white noise. But it was over eventually. We thought we were safe. And then it turned out it was also comedy night, which was awful. So that's when we relocated. So I go out to – but the other bar we were going to go to is only like a block away. So I go out and I go to get my bike and move it to the new place. And I've got a flat tire. I'm like, son of a bitch. So a couple other people were just walking. So I walked with them, and then when we got to the new bar, I start changing my tire. But I've already had like 5 or 6 beers at this point.
Right.
So changing a bike is they're Kevlar, and then they're also lined with steel belting. And so you have to somehow force this Kevlar and steel lining off of the rim and get all that going. And I got it off. I put the new tube in. Skipped a couple of vital steps, like checking for debris and all that, and making sure there wasn't glass poking through somewhere because I was a little too buzzed. And I get the thing almost all the way back. Getting it on is like worse than getting it off. But I finally get the tire back on, except for one little bit that I have to force up over the rim of the wheel. And the tool you use kind of looks – it's like a shoehorn for tires, basically. So it's just like a wedge. And I jammed it up too hard into the tire, I guess. And I punctured the new tube with the thing. So all the air comes out. And I don't carry a pump with me. I carry these little CO2 cartridges that have like just enough air in them to inflate one tire and get you home. Because having inflated a high-pressure racing tire once or twice with a hand pump, I decided I never need to do that ever again. So now I've punctured the new tube, and Frankie, very helpful now, is like, maybe you should check the old one and make sure, you know, maybe there's not actually a hole in it. He's like, maybe some jackass just let the air out of your tire. And yeah, of course, some jackass let the air out of my tire. There was no hole in the tube at all. So I wasted like 20 minutes unsuccessfully changing the tire, and then I didn't have enough air left in the CO2 tank
right.
to even if I put it on the bike. So I texted Dorinda around like 12:30, quarter to one, and was just like, "Yeah, I'm gonna be walking home. It's 4 miles. I'll get there around 1:30 in the morning." But she's like, "Forget it. I'm already up. I'll come get you." It was great fun, and it was dark. And I was drunk. So my knuckles this morning are all sliced up and bleeding and very painful.
Well, good thing you don't need your hands.
Right, for anything. I am, of course, drawing with my feet right now, as you can see.
Oh, as usual.
Yeah. Other than that, though, it was a super fun night. But, I mean, I've left that bike in like a million crappy neighborhoods and it has never been messed with. But, of course, on Staten Island.
Yeah.
So, man, and the only place to chain the bike up near this this brewery is right near the bottom of the trains there. And there's like a bridge that goes over the train tracks and the stairs come down like right there. So, you know, it's all like high school kids who are out doing whatever, coming home. Man.
You got statined.
I did get statined, yeah.
I think the chat only works for you and me.
Oh, God.
Yeah, this is ridiculous. Okay, well, I'm going to do some research on why does the Q&A app not work. God damn. Google. Sort yourself out, buddy.
What does Google do with all its free time and piles of money?
Well, what it does is you'll do a Google search for, let's say, anything at all, and the first page of responses is going to be Yahoo Answers questions. And the questions phrased from 13-year-olds and answered by 14-year-olds because, you know, they're world-weary. To set up the Hangout Q&A app. Why is there a walkthrough? I should click on the button and that's it. There's only the host who can enable. Good to know.
All right, well, hopefully in a few minutes, guys, we'll have the ability to actually interact with you. Otherwise, it's going to be an hour and a half of us just clearing our throats at each other.
Creatively.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, okay. I need this link. Boom, that should do it. Okay. Ah. No.
you find an answer?
I'm finding one currently. Because it couldn't possibly be simple.
No, push the button's not an option.
Yeah. And it's great. This is the other wonderful thing about Google, and that I was complaining about before the broadcast. You know, you'll in a miracle strike, you'll find a useful walkthrough for whatever it is you're looking for. But because they change the graphical interface every 6 hours, it's useless. Like, it's very in depth. Ah, yeah. So this is a very lengthy walkthrough using a layout that no longer applies. And what it boils down to is click the Q&A app to enable it.
And when I do that,
it just says... It's
why didn't you think of that, Brian?
I don't know. I guess I'm done.
Worry, guys, eventually we'll figure it out.
Whatever, you're drawing cool stuff. Why would it be disabled? Just makes no sense.
I wonder if any... Oh, that's awesome. Can you see that?
Hang on, I got like a million windows here. What am I looking at here?
It's Star Wars Celebration. I got friends who are out there for like the eighth time. Like, how many times can you go?
I still like Star Wars.
I haven't got, you know, how many times can you go and get like the autograph from Stormtrooper number 7? I'm the one who hit my head on the door frame coming in through. Oy.
Okay. Q&A app, you bastard.
Huh?
Oh, just Google's official support for the Q&A app. Click the Q&A app. I know. I did, and it tells me that it's disabled. Now what, you piece of...
Step the next, please.
Oh, you... God... All right, so I finally found what's up. It says, things to keep in mind. This is the very last thing it has. The Q&A app will only appear if the host enables it before the broadcast begins.
Before the broadcast begins.
And I did. Because I clicked on it to see, oh, does it work?
Excellent.
Whatever, next time.
Yeah, maybe.
It won't work, but for a different reason.
Yeah, Frankie said he was going to email, Twitter me a link to something that was supposed to help us with our streaming problems, but I think he forgot.
He probably forgot.
He was pretty drunk at the time, so.
Yeah.
But he was sincere, and he is a huge computer nerd, so I'm sure he can fix it.
Well, we got it to work. It's just now this doesn't, and now maybe we can get Q&A to work next time.
Q&A worked last time.
I know. And I believe we did.
Except I had to control it, which was a giant pain in the butt.
Right, because, yeah.
Because, like, right now I can't see the Google chats at all, or the Hangout, or whatever the hell it is.
But last time, because we had a few false starts and stops.
Just a couple.
You also found out, the Q&A app won't work unless I enable it before we start. So that was one of the starts. Yeah, that was one of the starts and stops.
Hmm.
And we got it to work last time because you just undid it and then redid it with the thing. So that's why I was sure before I started to click on the Q&A app to enable it. But
nope. Well, I suppose if anyone is following us on Twitter, they could put their questions
there.
What's that?
They could ask questions
there. They could ask Twitter. You can see that, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. More impetus for the people not following us on Twitter to hurry up and go do that.
My parents just texted me.
Your parents? Are they our two viewers?
No. But they let me know that the History Channel is showing Ancient Aliens.
Yes.
So, of course, we are watching it to rot our brains. Sean wants you to draw a steampunk robo.
A steampunk robo. Okay. I will do that just as soon as I finish this this power armor, because I'm almost done now. I'm in the home stretch. Isn't robo already kind of steampunky? Like, does he mean like with a monocle? Maybe a utilikilt?
Just put gears on him.
Okay.
No, here you gotta. He gets colored, bronze and brown instead of silver.
Give him like a silly hat, top hat, perhaps.
Call him Coal Robo. Trevor wants to know if we can discuss any other information about the hardcovers.
Oh, I think we can discuss all the information about the hardcovers.
I don't know about that.
Also, Trevor, is that same Trevor who
who we tried to coordinate doing the podcast questions with?
Could be.
I'm sure he will tell you. Just through the amazing lightning fast medium of the Twitters. Well, anyway, while he does that, yeah. Go ahead, Brian. Tell him all about the hardcovers.
Man, I don't know. Don't know nothing about no hardcovers.
Well done.
I know that they, yeah. Hey, I don't listen at the meetings.
You don't pay attention to meetings at all. No.
I figure if it's important, you got one of you guys will wake me up.
Wake you up?
Right. I mean, what is there to say? They'll have new fancy covers. There's going to be some new bonus content.
Well, so you gotta remember, like, none of these people have been in the many meetings with us. They have no idea what's going on, other than that there's a Kickstarter happening, and I've been drawing covers lately.
Okay, yeah. So we're going to do a Kickstarter pretty soon.
Four.
I'm getting to that. Sentences are made out of words in order. So we're doing a Kickstarter soon. And it's going to be for reprinting our comics in trade paperback format, and there will be hardcovers.
It's only going to be hardcovers, right?
I think so. I mean, there might be other stuff, but the books themselves will be in hardcover.
Yes, because now that Red 5 is no longer publishing us, we don't actually have any books. Whoops. Probably should have thought that went through a little.
We really did not think about that. Trevor confirms that this is the same Trevor.
Oh, okay, cool. Yeah, I was thinking sometime we should probably, since we will never have time to write out long answers to those questions, like maybe sometime we should do like a Google, like we could do the interview via the Hangout, either the public one or set a time up for a private one.
Yeah.
I don't know how to read. Well, because it records to your YouTube channel, so he would then have a record of the...
Yeah. No, yeah, just next time we do a live stream, and we'll advertise it, you know, ahead of time. And if he can make it, then we'll just invite him on to do the questions, we'll give him the answers. And if he can't make it to that one, then it'll just be the one after that, and, you know, whatever. We have more questions. Phil.
Science Phil?
Our very favorite Science Phil.
Our Phil. Is he listening to Herb Alpert right now as he types?
I don't know. But he wants to know your favorite kind of plane, train, and automobile to draw.
None of them. They're all hard.
They all are made of shapes. I hate them.
The shapes are the worst. I do not know. Currently, my favorite thing to draw is the new Science Van, but I don't think they're going to have that past Volume 10.
I don't know if they have it past Issue 1.
They don't have it past Issue 1, but in my head canon, which I realize is ridiculous since it's my comic, I don't have to have head canon. I could just make it canon somehow, but since I'll never have time to draw it out.
Guest starring Science Van.
Da-na-na-na-na-na. But it's based on this really cool, like, custom Hemi van I found. Let's see. Planes, trains. But anyway, more modern cars, which is great because, like, all the volumes we've had, for the most part, except for 6, that required cars. It was always, like, old-timey cars with Jack Tarrow stuff and the Volume 2 stuff. No, Volume 3. And, man, those things are nothing but angles and weird shapes and wagon wheels. Just a mess. But I don't know. Cars are hard. I try to really loosen up when I'm drawing them. And just like, I love how, what's his name? Like, Milo Giannis.
Yeah.
Old City Blues guy. Like he has like a really cool style of drawing modern cars. And I try to kind of go loose and just let it happen, but it never does.
Yeah. A lot of his tech, and cards especially, they look amazing, but they don't
look like they would work.
Yeah, they don't quite work.
Right. I think
I love them, and I can't stop looking at them.
I think that's what my brain can't let go of.
Yeah.
Planes. I don't know. Things that don't have propellers.
And yet you love World War II planes.
I didn't say I love drawing them. Oh. Well, propellers are harder-ish. They can be, anyway, because it's just, there's a lot of, especially with, like, wing-mounted engines, you got to, like, figure out a lot of strange geometry to make it work.
Or no, it's easy.
Off.
It's easy to write a plane.
Yeah. It's easy to write just about anything, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, actually.
I mean, you could just put Kurt down in front of a typewriter and go on vacation, and I would never know the difference.
You should say I don't.
Good point. And trains, oh man, I don't know. Not old timey air trains. They are hard. I can't say we've ever had cause to use a modern train, though, have we?
No. I think the most modern train we've done was in World War II.
Yes. Which, that was way harder to draw than the train in Volume 9, just because I'd never drawn a train before. Fingers.
Jay says that he sees that there's a Majestic 12 source book for the Atomic Robo role-playing game, and he wants to know if we have any plans for more. Sort of, yes. I know that Evil Hat wants to do more, and I know that I want to do more, and I know that lead designer Mike Olson wants to do more. It's just a matter of, I guess, economics. We're not yet sure what shape these will take, necessarily. I know one idea that was thrown around was that we'll do the Majestic 12 book, and it'll be its own thing. And then there might be another book that kind of encapsulates several other bad guy outfits like Majestic 12. Because there's enough there to detail them and to do some fun stuff with them. But I don't know if there's enough there to do a separate book for each. And, you know, why force you guys to buy a bunch of filler when we can just kind of shove them all into one book? And we also really want to do 19th century expansion, you know, the Centurions of Science and all that stuff. There's a lot of material there to mine. Give you a whole other main book, basically. But we won't go that far because that's just crazy. So, yeah. It's less plans and more like desires. But it seems likely that if the Majestic 12 book does well, then obviously, you know, that pushes things forward.
I forget, is the Majestic 12 book going to be a physical book or an ebook? I can't remember.
You know, I don't know either. We've gone back and forth, and I don't remember where we finally settled on that. I mean, worst case scenario, we would probably do even more books, and they would just be ebooks exclusively.
Hmm. I know at one point we talked about also doing a couple of them, like an adventure book.
Oh, yeah.
and this stuff, and doing them as ebooks first, and then once we had a bunch of them, collecting them into a physical book.
Yeah, that is totally.
That came up, but I am not as involved on the RPG side as you are. Which reminds me, I got to draw them a cover next week, don't I?
Oh, crap. Ruben wants to know, speaking of the RPG, where would we put Tesladyne West as an offshoot office for his NPCs? I'm going to say
Burbank.
Why Burbank?
I don't know. Just the first thing that popped into my head.
Just like this, you just like the way that sounds.
I do. Burbank just sounds like a kind of seedy, second-rate kind of place. So apologies to anyone who might live there. But
I'm the mayor of Burbank, fella. I'm going to go... I've been watching crazy reruns, so I'm going to say Seattle.
Seattle. Nothing happens in Seattle.
Hey, easy job.
Ghost of Steve Jobs. We need to bring Steve Jobs back like we did with Thomas Edison.
Oh, yeah. That would be great.
Hey, bad press is still press, Brian.
Just look at the DC movie. Hey!
Oh, my God. Did everyone see that trailer? It's been so hard for me to not go on some dumb, pointless nerd rage on Twitter. Like, I didn't think it was real. I thought it was like some stupid spliced together fan thing. Like, wow, this looks terrible. What? This is real?
Imagine the millions of dollars being spent on that.
Just I'm trying. That could be making a robo movie right now.
Yeah. Do you robo bleed? That would be Dr. Dinosaur's line.
I just don't see how it's a movie. I really don't. Like, what's the story exactly? It's
okay.
Okay.
Did you see the Man of Steel movie?
Yes, I did.
Okay. Remember the end fight with Zod, roughly?
Yes, where all of Metropolis gets trashed, but right. No one gets hurt.
Just,
yeah.
Right. It's pointless. Just weird violence. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure it's just going to be that.
Right.
2 straight hours.
Okay. Without the hour of walking around like what's his name? David Kane? No, David.
As Kane?
Yeah, the kung fu guy.
Yeah.
Who hung himself masturbating in a closet.
You're going into some strange places here.
I didn't masturbate to death in a closet.
Yeah, right. Give it time. Yet. I don't know. I actually never saw Man of Steel except for just the end fight in a hotel room. And
see, I thought up to that point.
I was laughing. It was crazy.
Yeah. I thought up to that point it was fine. It was kind of like, oh, yeah.
I didn't
think it was a really laid-back Superman movie. But it was, it was interesting. It kind of meandered. It reminded me, I know Kevin Costner played his dad, but was he involved otherwise?
I have no idea.
It kind of reminded me of, like, remember after Dancing with Wolves when Kevin Costner went insane and started making, like, 3-hour epic movies about nothing?
Right.
It felt like that. And then suddenly there was a fight.
And everyone dies. But not on screen.
But not for reals.
Dave.
Do I care about putting this hand there? Is this okay without the hand, right? It doesn't need a big care about a hand there. I think that looks fine, yeah?
I don't even see a hand.
Well, I just erased it.
Oh. Looks great.
But I've been drawing it for the last 15 minutes.
Yeah, you don't need a hand there.
Like, right here. Like, do I need another?
I mean, it would be nice, but it's not. I don't think it's necessary.
Well, it is a cover.
Yeah, but I mean, it's still a robot. Like, that's where they're no one's going to be, power armor. Nobody's going to be looking at this armor going, well, where's the hand?
Well, I'm just saying for dynamic reasons.
That does look nice.
Yeah, all right, fine. I'll fix that.
It looks like it will become nice. I should
right. Done. Ink it.
Only work on these covers for 3 hours. So you get what you get.
This is what you get, kids.
Dave would like to know if we have any advice to a young 13-year-old comic type artist who might be listening.
Oh man, there's young people listening. have to start censoring. just tons and tons and tons of practice. I did not. When I was a kid, I practiced all the time, but I didn't realize I was going to end up being a cartoonist. And you have to draw everything. I have sketchbooks and sketchbooks full of like what I thought were cool characters just standing there looking cool. They weren't actually like interacting with things or doing anything, or I don't know. It was more like doing character design than drawing comics, and the two things are completely different. So when I started actually drawing comics, that was really all I knew how to do, was to draw a person standing there in a static pose. And I still love stuff like that. Like, it's like, I like a lot of Mignola covers are like that, and I love them. They all look like weird old, like turn of the century portraits, but it does not make, unless you are Mike Mignola, it does not make for a very interesting cover. Drawing everything, like the first several volumes of Atomic Robo was me realizing that, like, every day on every page, that whatever Brian was asking for, I had never drawn before in my life. Like, things like telephones, cars.
Backgrounds,
yeah. Buildings. Basically, seriously, look around the room you're in, anything you see, I had not really drawn it before. And then also really studying from life. I used to get told this all the time, and I ignored it. Because if we want to draw life, I want to draw, like, you know, anime. But that really is the best. Like, if you're going to be a cartoonist, like, don't really study at this point. Don't really study other comic book creators to learn how to do what you're doing. You can study them to be like, oh, I like how he tells a story, or for like the feel of things. But if you really want to learn to be a good artist, you've got to go to like life drawing classes and go out in the world and draw what you see and really find your inspiration outside of the medium. Like, I'd say like what, like 90% of Atomic Robo is inspired by things that we're interested in that have nothing to do with comics. And studying film is also a good idea. And by studying, I just mean watching a whole lot of movies. Seeing how the camera is used to set up shots and create emotion. In fact, some of the best books I got for making comics were, there are lots of terrible books about how to make comics. And I don't actually think there are any good ones. Except for the Scott McCloud books. Those are good. But I went to like Barnes and Nobles and found some discount books on basic camera techniques for film. And the language is essentially the same for storyboarding. And storyboarding is basically comics. And that's a really good way to learn how to do it. And then once you're comfortable with what you're doing, that's when you kind of start stealing from other artists.
Borrowing. Borrowing from other artists.
Far away? I can't hear you.
Borrowing.
Borrowing, yeah, no. It's outright theft. He's got to change it enough so no one can pin it. Yeah. How do I turn that off? There. Nope. There we go.
No, it's all crooked.
Yeah.
We can't print it like that.
But you're into the purple, right? We're good with that?
Purple's fine.
Let's see. Where's Alex Milne when I need a good robot hand drawn? Oh, I know.
I'll just trace one.
Yeah. Here in my robot hand file, actually.
What about Devin's robo hands?
Devin's?
Yeah.
What about them?
Are those of any use?
Oh, you mean the ones he made for the cosplay?
Yeah.
No, I mean, I know what he did there, but they're, because it's a glove, it's not as helpful as you would think it would be.
Okay, this guy's going to get, like, credit.
Alex Milne, he draws Transformers. Yeah, he can have some credit. That's fine.
Let's put his name a little smaller next to yours.
Just need something to look at here.
No, keep it.
Just trace it? Yeah. I could if I reverse it and then be pointing it red.
Why are you pointing it?
Why are you stabbing me?
Dave also would like to know what it is you used to draw.
What it is I used to draw? Well, right now I am drawing on a Cintiq, a tablet. I've got it's a Cintiq 24 HD. You can Google that for the specs, but recently came into possession of this. It was a gift, actually, from some really awesome friends.
Clients, really,
yes. They're just ensuring my loyalty and that I can keep working to make comics for them. So less a gift, more of a prepayment on things they're already getting. Yeah, I used to work. I had a small Cintiq, a 12WX, I think it was called, which is the smallest they make that you can actually draw on the screen. That's not like a tablet, like a bamboo. And I worked on that for a couple of months. I mean, I've had it for a couple of years, but I only started drawing digitally when we started doing the webcomic. And it was a little tough to get things done on that because the workspace was really, really small. Like, I could have all I would be able to see on that would be this hand here, and I wouldn't be able to see any of the things around it. So you get keeping things in proportion to each other and scale and having an idea in your head of what's going on the page was really difficult on that thing. It was great for just fun drawing. And it was a very good, my first tablet to make sure I actually could draw on the thing. It's actually, I'm finding it's a lot, it's more convenient as you start to learn it, but it's actually a lot harder to draw on the tablet than it is on paper. Because there's no tooth to the screen. There's no friction. And I've tried all sorts of different nibs, and some people tell me to put tracing paper over the monitor, but I don't know. It's not, tracing paper is not that transparent. So I don't really like the effect you get with that. All right, that finger's good enough. Like right now I'm working with it's a rubberized nib. So it's kind of like a number two pencil where where what would have been the lead is like a plastic tip. And then it's wrapped in a rubber sheath that's supposed to create some friction, but I'm not noticing it does. And I've also tried the hard felt nibs. I think they're my favorite. And then the program I'm working in is called Sketchbook Pro, which you can probably see on the screen share. And it is my absolute favorite program to draw on. There's a lot it can't do that like something like Photoshop could do, or Manga Studio, which is set up to make comics. But I've used all those. And as far as artistically, the most intuitive and easiest to work in and the most fun to work in is definitely Sketchbook. And I've often taken a piece almost to completion in here, and then if I needed to do something fancy schmancy that the program couldn't do, I'd then open it up in one of the other programs. But I can't really remember the last time I've had to do that, except for today where I needed some technical help with separating some line work from the background, like actual photo editing things. So why would a DeArt program be able to do that? You know, I'll finish this finger off in purple, and then I will start a new document, and I can show you some of the reasons why I love working in Sketchbook. Get that steampunk robo going. All right, yeah, that'll look better. Cool.
I feel like I'm downloading important documents.
In a way.
Any suggestions for fate tokens for an Atomic Robo game? Actual slivers of plutonium.
Perfect.
Definitely get your hands on those.
Asbestos.
Actually, I legit don't know. What did we use when Mike played for us?
We played in person?
Yeah.
I can't Patron drive live draw. I don't know. I don't remember actually. I think he just had like poker chips, I think. I don't know. I found a really awesome poker set, like with tons of chips, this big like a Lazy Susan contraption.
Right.
I back when I lived in New Hampshire, and I've always held on to the thing just because I always knew I would have a use for this, even though I haven't played poker since college. But I now have like 800 fate tokens.
Well, that'll come in handy when you move down here and are running a game.
Yeah, no, I don't have time for that. You're the writer. You got all the free time. You should run a game.
Hell no.
All righty. What was I drawing? Steampunk Robo.
Give him a stovepipe coming out of his mouth as a pipe. Good ideas, man.
So like the first reason I love this program is this tool I'm working with now, which is just their regular pencil, number two pencil tool, and it actually draws like a real pencil, and no other program has that. And I've never seen a custom brush that was good like that. It's actually just fun to draw with. Some big swoopy ideas in here.
Attila wants to know, what is Robo's music of choice? Jazz, heavy metal, electro swing, or what?
Well, we established that he's a fan of big band music, which given his age doesn't exactly make sense. I would think jazz more, but he's also, you know, his musical tastes change. I don't know. Other than the big band stuff, I don't think we really have...
He sings a couple of Johnny Cash tunes in Volume 3.
That's true. He does. Yeah, he does like Good Country. I don't like that. I think jazz. I think he would love jazz.
Of course you do.
But that's because I love jazz. that's not gonna work.
That should be a gear.
Gears are hard to draw, Brian.
That's not my problem.
Yeah. Folks, if you had any idea how many times I've heard that.
It's hard to draw. Oh, it's hard to draw.
It's all hard to draw.
Oh, there's these 12 panels that are all half a page large. Hard to draw on one page.
You're good at that. And then having three pages of people just standing around talking that could all be crammed into half a page. I wonder what the picture in your head is like when you're writing a lot of the time.
Nothing.
People in a white room having conversations.
I don't even bother.
See, this is why I should work with like Phil Hester, because he actually like draws out his stories. So he knows ahead of time.
Do you really want that to happen?
Well, you don't have to stick to it, but he draws out layouts so he knows that what he writes fits on the page well. Now, the idea of getting to see you draw, that would be amazing.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, I think that would be great. Now we see where you're going with this. Yes. I watched you draw dinosaurs when we were signing all those Kickstarter books.
Yeah, that wasn't me like drawing down to like...
No, you were like your tongue was out. You were like sweating. There was like some serious concentration going on. Oh, that is another thing I absolutely love about this program. I can just put by pushing one of the buttons on my do you see the little radio menu that pops up here?
Yeah.
Yeah. I can just hit a button on my pen, I can zoom in and out and fade around.
Well, look at that, that's the animation right there. Our new Atomic Robo web series here. Hey kids. Why my book? And yes, that canonically is exactly Robo's voice.
Is that what he sounds like? I've always wondered.
I guess it's science time.
I quit.
You think we could trick Alex and Lindsay into doing an animated shorts of Robo, but in the style of really super cheap 60s animation?
Yeah, probably. I would love to see them done like the Schoolhouse Rock videos or those weird little cartoons that used to be on between the cartoons.
Yeah.
Saturday. Like the one with the stomach. And he's a cowboy. He's got a hanker for a hunk of cheese.
I vaguely remember that.
when your 10-gallon hat's feeling 5 gallons flat, Brian? How do you not remember this? And he is a stomach with legs and like a Mr. Peanuts cane.
Dana wants to know if Robo can tap dance. It is, she admits, a dumb question, but she's curious what weird skills he's picked up over the years.
That's a good question.
Kind of.
You're the writer.
No, I don't think he can tap dance.
I've often wondered how he picks up dimes and pennies and things like that.
Well, I would assume with his fingers.
Yeah, but he's got big metal fingers. It's not like
There's
no squish to them, you know? I mean, I guess like his modern hands. Well, I suppose Tesla could have put some kind of rubberized thing on the tips, but.
Maybe, I don't know. Maybe he just, you know, can precisely do it. I don't know. Maybe Robo, throughout his entire life, has had to say, keep the change. Please.
Oh, my math didn't work out too well on that. I also love the undo function of all drawing programs. It's the best.
He's looking a bit proper here.
Yeah, well, you want steampunk.
He's powered by imperialism and...
racism.
Oh.
I mean, yeah, that's the era in a nutshell.
What ho, indigenous people?
Godless savages. What? heck would his hands look like? Just have them wear gloves.
It would be proper.
It would.
Tripper asks, from a writer's perspective,
who cares about that?
Yeah, it's not a big deal. talk to me about Alan as a character, especially after all we saw in Volume 5, shaping Robo's early life. Alan. It's a tough one. I guess the idea that I was interested in was sort of addressing the trope of, you know, all the computers are going to take over and kill us all, which I don't really believe in. But I think with Alan, it was just a matter of having to grow up in, you know, complete isolation and just never having a moral guide of any kind. So I suppose he just very early on would have learned to see people and humans and our civilization and our tools as just implements, not really ends unto ourselves. And, you know, with his one major, goal or mission to just learn things, you know, he learned enough about us to realize, well, human culture is largely just goes in cycles. It just kind of endlessly looks at itself and comes up with new things every so often. But it's not a big loss to get rid of them if it means learning about the whole universe. There's bound to be other life out there to study at some point. So it's not that he was evil, really. He was just indifferent and really callous. You know, if he had figured out a way to accomplish what he wanted and not probably poison the entire biosphere, he would have done that. But on the time scale that he was looking at, he needed to get out of Earth as soon as possible in as big of a ship as possible to have as many resources as possible. And as sort of the remainder at the end of that equation, all of humanity and probably all of life on Earth will die. Oh, well, no big loss. There's a whole other universe out there. I have no idea if that was a decent answer, but there you go.
Well, that was you're interested in it, but I think he said how Alan shaped Robo's early life?
No, how did Alan, why did Alan turn out that way? Versus Robo, who got to live in the human world and be more or less treated as a human.
Yeah, it'd be fun to bring Alan back.
Yeah, he's a really, when we started, I didn't really think basically what I just described was as far as I thought about it. But he's really an interesting foil for Robo and kind of a personal, I don't know. But Trevor follows up here with another tweet about the disgust on Robo's face when he empties the second set of rounds into the, you know, main CPU.
Mm.
And it, you know, it struck me that it would strike Robo in just a very personal way and really anger him in a way that most of the other, you know, quote unquote villains he's faced hasn't. Because Alan, you know, once you realize the full reach of his power and influence and the way that he used it and what he could have done instead, it's just this tremendous, profound waste of resources, energy, talent, you know, scientific learning and so on. You know, stuff that Robo's dedicated his life to, so.
Well, it's a good thing I added that extra panel to the last page.
Yeah.
My entire contribution to that story.
I think he did a little more than that.
Drew a couple things, but.
Like 3 pages.
Right.
Is he getting a cane?
No.
Oh, you should have a cane. You should have a,
oh, okay,
a lightsaber cane.
Oh, wait, I know. His hands is all wrong for that, but all right, whatever. Hands are hard, kids. Yes, our young friend from earlier, learn to draw hands. Spend a lot of time learning to draw hands. Give him a Gatling cane. Assuming I can figure out how.
Yeah, that makes a whole lot of sense. Why not?
That makes total steampunk sense. Feet too. Oh God, feet are hard. Basically, it's all hard. Get ready for that, kid. But especially in comics, because you spend most of your time drawing everyone from the waist up, when you finally have to do, unless you're drawing like an action comic, which I guess we are, but I guess I'm talking like
nothing exciting ever.
Nothing exciting ever happens. That's correct. I'm talking like, you know, like nonstop, like, you know, if you're drawing Naruto, chances are you're drawing people like in extremely dynamic poses all the time. But I always try to keep Robo a little less frenetic than that, because in my head, Robo is basically Ghostbusters, but with science and robots instead of, and like that was, you know, more working class schlubs who aren't interested in, you know, posing and backflips and stuff like that. Alrighty. Ooh, that's too big.
Trevor asks if we're going to do any more Sagan adventures.
We had one in mind, but it got the 80s action scientist one with Sagan, Feynman. Who else was it? I had Neil deGrasse Tyson Jr. as the young guy. And
the rookie.
Wasn't there another one, or was it just those two? Feynman, Sagan, and Robo.
I don't remember.
And it was going to basically be like the A-Team, but with those guys. Mostly because Feynman had a radical van that he had all sorts of like math painted on the side of it.
A math magician?
Mm-hmm. Let's see. Boring you, Brian?
I'm just tired. Damn cats wake me up at 6:30.
Yeah, my child does that. Oops.
No.
Show's over. Oh, no Pitbull. Get out of here.
I'm getting stared at, so I better feed these animals.
Check to see if anyone has any questions first.
Nope.
All right. Damn it. I hate the silence. The thing that drives me nuts about robot fingers is that, you know, all fingers have three joints, but you always shorthand that in cartoons. So, like, you have, like, your index finger. You, like, that's a very typical way of drawing them. And it's kind of like the shorthand is that your third joint, that you got the one here, and then you draw this one. And the third one's right behind the fingernail, but you never really draw it. Unless you're doing super hyper realistic, but obviously I am not doing that. And that's great, and it's a lot of fun. But then you come to Robo, and it's like, hey, he just has these weird giant two-jointed fingers that don't make any sense.
Did you miss me?
Who are you?
What?
Huh?
What the hell are those scrawls off to the side?
This?
Yeah.
Oh, I was explaining how Robo's hands are a nightmare as a cartoony drawer, because in cartoony styles, animation styles, you shorthand a finger where it's only got one, two joints.
Uh-huh, right.
But, and that's really strange. So usually for like if this was Robo's hand, that was Robo's hand. I would draw that, but then I just put in like a knuckle under there, and then instead of figuring out all the other crap, I just do like a zigzag line there.
Yeah, you do, don't you?
Well, and it works really well a lot of the time until you try to do like a close-up of his hand, and then it's like, what's going on here?
Oh, no.
Something's wrong. It's like a little, it's like the uncanny valley for hands. But Steampunk Robo would probably just have weird, but I'm not happy with
gloves.
Yeah, gloves. That sounds like a lot, like a really good idea. The more I struggle with this doodle. This is another great thing in Sketchbook. You get these little, these pucks. And so I just put the pen down on it and drag left and right to change the pen width. And the same thing for the eraser. What was I at on that though? Now I gotta remember where I was. I think that's right. But then I just flip the pen, you know, your eraser is the same way. It's nice. You can also manipulate the colors with that, but I don't use the color puck very often. Where's the color puck?
I'll be right back.
Okay. I need a new color. There we go.
I'm back.
That was quick. Yeah, gloves are indeed the way to go here. Now I can get away with the two joints.
Oh, this feels weird.
Hmm?
So this feels weird. I'm at the kitchen table, basically.
Yeah.
But sitting facing the television, and so I'm starting up Destiny, but I'm not used to playing from this far away, so it feels funny.
You're playing video games while we do this, really?
I just started, yeah.
Ugh. What are you playing, Destiny?
Yeah.
I don't know how you guys have maintained interest in that. The game's so boring. I mean, I don't know what I was expecting. It's the same idiots who made Halo, which was also really boring, but what do I know, obviously, because millions of people love that game, but
no, I hated the Halo games. Uh-oh. It's getting beeped.
I just, the production on Destiny, just like, ugh. How can you make me hate Peter Dinklage so much? I love Peter Dinklage. But the writing is just terrible.
Oh, yeah, it is the worst. I play with the volume all the way down. That's not a joke.
I did enjoy the few times I played with you and Frankie, but every other time I've tried to play by myself, it's like, oi. Yeah, I'm excited for the new game by the guys who did Borderlands, because that will be fun. And I'm,
oh, yeah, that's PC only, I think.
Is it? Oh. Yeah.
I think.
Because it basically looked like Team Fortress, which is an awesome game. I don't remember what I was doing with his elbow. Not that. See, now I bet you guys have all been saving your questions. So since Brian's playing video games, you should ask them now.
Well, Trevor does ask if Robo has ever had a pet.
I don't think so. Unless you count Tesla's pigeons.
Or Bernard.
Bernard, yeah. He's got Bernard, yeah. So, yes, through the mid-90s into the... at least the first 15 years of the 21st century, he had Bernard. Does that count? I think that should count.
He's getting a little long in the tooth.
What's that?
So Bernard is getting a little long in the tooth.
I know, he's our age.
Crap.
A sultan in your onion head, cat.
Well, Charlie is about to step on the laptop.
Well, it's warm, right?
Yeah.
Let's see. Well, don't let him close the... So if the on-air thing suddenly stops, it's Charlie's fault?
Yeah. Yeah, out of all the incredibly dumb things about Destiny, the ones that annoy me the most, and it's like the dumbest complaint to even have, but it's the geography that they have for the Moon and Mars and Venus. Because we've been to those places.
Yeah.
We have Google Maps of them. Like, yeah. It should not. What are they doing?
Yeah. Well, but the cube or whatever that thing is.
Yeah.
Must have changed it all.
They do make some kind of...
A giant space MacGuffin.
They do make a vague notion about, oh, well, it magically terraforms these places. That doesn't create these valleys and these huge mountains out of nowhere.
Well, I hope someone from Bungie's watching this.
Oh, they better
your advice under consideration.
I don't know why it irritates me every time, but it does. Like, even the Earth map. I mean, this is a place on Earth. This is literally the Cosmodrome.
It's all wrong.
This is not what Kazakhstan looks like, guys.
Yeah.
Of course, if that rant to make any sense, I should have been doing it in the nerd voice. Excuse me, sirs.
That was a mistake. Do not try and draw 23 octagonal barrels all lined up. Just circles are fine.
Well, now you know what to do when we do the real steampunk robo.
When what?
When we do the real steampunk robo.
So should I poke you every now and then, check for questions, or is Lydia sitting there doing your job for you?
As usual. No, I'm. I'm See, as a pro tier gamer, Scott, I can occasionally glance away.
You can read Twitter and game at the same time.
Yeah,
I believe it.
Well, you've seen how good I am.
Mm-hmm.
No further commentary necessary. Everyone heard you grunt in the more or less affirmative. Well, that looks like a finished, more or less, robo.
Yeah, more or less. We're getting there.
The all-important crud stage.
Mm-hmm. I find mostly it's important just for my own psychological well-being at this point, because when I erase the undersketch...
Oh, yeah, it doesn't look dirty enough.
Yeah, it doesn't look all messed up, yeah.
Yeah, the undersketch does get blended a certain depth.
Yeah, right. And when I was drawing on physical pages, that's, yeah. You know, before I got cleaned up the scans, that's what it always looked like.
No, I like the crud. I've always liked the crud.
Yes, I know you're a fan of the crud. I would like to do something in like a less... Don't have to worry about the crud. Just do something like with the pencil tool in a sketchy style. But I haven't quite figured out how I can do that in a way that my OCD brain will let go of it. And I mean, like, this is pretty sloppy, but... But even so, it's getting pretty well-defined containment lines. And oof. Man, circles are hard.
Circles are hard, octagons are hard, robots are hard, backgrounds
hard. You hear this kid, it's all really, really hard. That's what they never tell you. Drawing is really, really hard. Like, wow, it's just so much fun. Like, no, I want to go out of my mind half the time, but in a good way.
Well, imagine the alternative. You could be, whatever it is people do for a job.
I've never had a regular, like, just airplanes and then this. I don't know what, like, a regular, like, go to a place and sit there job is like.
Yeah, same. Except not airplanes. It was just more riding.
I mean, airplanes is sitting around, too, but at least you're moving in the thing you're sitting in.
Yeah, but it's like nobody is just sitting at work, you know, doing a spreadsheet, and they might die at 400 miles an hour.
True. Well, they don't know what they're missing.
Luckily, this thin sheet of aluminum will protect me.
Oh, yeah. Airplanes are extremely sturdy.
I think we all saw True Lies.
It's like in Star Trek where all the shuttles are made out of, like, I don't know what, space materials that make them impervious to all sorts of damage. Space tellurium, yes.
By the way, I'm totally wrecking fools, even though I am way far away from the screen.
I can't do that if I'm not sitting the right distance. Like, it screws up my whole game on first-person shooters. I remember what a time I broke my back?
You had to stand, right?
I had to stand in game for... Oh, that wasn't because of my back. It's because I also broke my tailbone at the same time. Great story, kids. But,
remember, learning to stand, kids, when you're 30, you're not 20.
Yes, remember that when you're 30, you're not 20. When you're 40, you're really not 20 anymore, as I am learning this week. But I did relearn a very good basic physics rule that a 200-pound man will go down a hill in a sled much faster than a 50-pound 8-year-old girl. I mean, obviously, at some point, we'd both hit terminal velocity and all that jazz, but...
I don't know. She might not have accelerated long enough to get to.
Well, that's what I'm saying. If it was an infinite hill.
Oh, okay.
And there was no wind resistance, right. We would eventually be falling at the same speed. But it felt like an infinite hill.
I bet it did in that moment.
Remember, I made you walk up at that one time you visited, and like you almost died.
I'm still. I think it was a blood sugar thing. I don't know.
I thought it was just because you were in New Hampshire. It wasn't Florida. What is this? It's called the cold, Brian. It's horrible.
I don't like it. I could have played a role too, because my body really does not know what to do with that kind of cold, but then getting warm from exertion, because I've literally never been in that kind of environment. So,
yeah, I'm already... looking forward to acclimating to Virginia.
It's nice.
If you like really hot places, it's great.
Oh, my God.
I survived your heat wave last summer. I'll make it.
I predict when you get here, you will realize it's not that hot.
It's not a dry heat, Brian. I'll notice it.
I don't know, the heat wave, because I was in the New York heat wave briefly last year.
Well, New York is just stifling because it's just the smog, the smog belt that hangs over the city.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Like, that felt worse than it does here.
Yeah, it's like wearing like a sweater inside your lungs. It's
good. So I think you will find that it is really not as bad as you.
No, fear probably will be. Not.
Like, we basically have a really super spring and fall, and it lasts for quite a while. And the locals think summer here is atrocious, but it just makes me want to kill them.
Lock that up.
They also think the winter is atrocious, and I do too, but that's because I know I'm an idiot.
Oh, yeah, geez, yeah, your winter was a joke this year.
Yeah. And everyone freaking out. I'm like, you know, I'm from Florida. Like, I should be having this reaction.
And the first year,
and then I got over it.
The only reason I know your winter was a joke is because I had to go down to try and do high school testing with Emma, and the schools kept closing on us. Because, oh my God, there was a quarter inch of snow. Since no one owns a shovel, they couldn't get rid of it. And then it did actually turn into a hazard at that point.
Self-fulfilling prophecy.
Yeah, exactly. Like, if you just take an hour, clean your driveway and your sidewalk, don't actually, like, you know, clean your whole car off if you're going to go out. Don't make that weird little porthole.
Yeah, so a lot of just strangeness on that thing, on that whole week. Because, like, I have a pretty decent view of the parking lot here, and everybody was, they would kind of stumble out to their car and look at it confused and start just pushing the snow off with their hands. And I'm just like, how do you have a scraper?
I watched a guy use a rolled up newspaper, yeah. Do you want a scraper? Like an actual? Yes.
I've got one of the long ones and a handheld, you know, tiny one.
You are prepared.
I know. I'm like, how do you people?
I was thinking of throwing mine away when we moved down there.
Yeah, you'll like, there's whole years where you don't need it, but then you will.
Mm.
Okay, I don't think I used mine at all last year.
Yeah, I watched Mitch, is it Gerard? The guy who colored our cowboy story for Nate, and who is now like super famous for doing Punisher. He is moving to Arizona, and he was in Minnesota or someplace like that. Yeah, he and his wife had this little ceremony of throwing away their ice scrapers forever. I was very jealous. I also really love this Copic marker set that comes with the sketchbook. I don't know if the kid who was interested in making comics is still on, but like, just to give you an idea of like all these folders here, these are all my reference photos. You just collect a lot of reference and learn to draw from it. This one is nothing but hands doing hand things. And I think I've drawn almost every one of these at least once.
It's kind of a lot of hands.
It is a lot of hands, yeah. And there's the cartoony hands here, but as you're seeing that. Any kind of tutorial you can collect on them. These are great. The old the Sorcerer in the Stone.
Oh yeah.
Disney hand. Love Don Bluth stuff. I actually met someone who doesn't like Don Bluth. For like a little while, I wasn't sure I could still be friends with her. But yeah, man, anything you can find. I have on my wall, I made this giant I went out and got foam board and printed out all the really good ones of these. And you know, as you can see, there are a lot of them, and I collaged them up. So my wall is nothing but a wall of hands to reference.
So basically, you look like a serial killer.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, with a hand fetish.
Hands of his victims. Law and Order: Staten Island.
Someday this will be my
your author photo.
Yes. I keep waiting for the right moment to use it. I've had it on my hard drive for like 5 years. Just waiting.
I have some GIFs like that.
I know you do. They're not GIFs. I don't care what you say. I don't care what the guy who makes them says. They are GIFs.
Whatever. You call it whatever.
Penis. Look, it's not peanut butter, buddy. Now comes the hour of playing with different layer settings and going to one or the one or two that I always go with because the others are all terrible. With it. I don't like that one. That's the other thing. I've got like a million textures and I always just go grab this one.
But one day you might not.
Maybe. You never know. And look at that. It even makes it look more steampunky.
Yes, that's amazing. So now his gloves look weird.
Weird?
Yeah.
What, color-wise or?
Yeah, because they're like, they're almost the only white thing.
Yeah, that happens. I gotta. There are too many stupid colors happening here.
I just ran my hover bike in a wall for you.
I appreciate the sacrifices you're willing to make for this. There's like steampunk Robo Riddler, which I'm okay with.
I can deal with it.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, so you should save that and put it in the Patreon. Although you can do it tomorrow if you are getting time.
Oh, can I? Thanks. Yeah, totally. And this is why you guys haven't been getting a whole lot of daily doodles, because you saw how long that took. Let's save that.
Charlie is snuggling up to the laptop.
All right, guys, last chance for questions because we're going to start wrapping it up here.
We got nothing.
Haha. Oh, I guess I might show them, though.
Uh-oh. Let's keep it safe for work, buddy.
It is work. It's going to go on the Patreon on Tuesday, but since they're here... actually, specifically since Trevor's here, he was curious about the, because I posted this the other on Twitter, I think he was curious about the, about seeing the finished product. Just need to, there we are. I think for Patreon, I'll leave all the sketchy stuff in there, but there it is, the redrawn cover.
Pretty cool.
I am very psyched with this one, yeah.
Yeah, I like the extra detail on the main sheet double there.
Yeah, yeah.
Like the flight suit and all.
Yeah, she was a lot of fun, but she took most of yesterday. And I sat down this morning, I was like, oh, nuts. And all this other stuff to draw, like these flying airships that were really hard to draw when I was drawing them on a semi-regular basis. Oh, yeah, kid, airships, hard to draw.
Airplanes, hard to draw. Cars,
totally
hard to
draw. Robots, hard
to
draw.
Pick up a dictionary, look at every single noun, hard to draw.
Absolutely, except for this Japanese naval ensign here, very easy. But other than that. But yeah, I think she came out really cool. Oh man, and if you're looking for tools to use for making comics, I should probably get off my mouse and get back on the pen here. Hang on. Gotta move this Cintiq. This program's awesome because it's got stuff like this, the perspective tool. So you can just set your vanishing points, your horizon line, and just kind of go nuts. Probably not do this on this.
It's some kind of wizardry,
right? Like Instant City. Rough Instant City, but still.
Good enough. Okay, so City's easy.
City's super easy if you have a computer with this kind of a perspective tool. Otherwise, very hard. I love this one too. There's a fisheye thing, so you can do like, oops, that's not what I meant to do. So you can actually get like fisheye perspective going on.
Fisheye, easy.
With this, yes. Otherwise, very hard. Love it. And the the symmetry thing is cool too.
Symmetry, easy.
With this, yes.
Otherwise, impossible.
Impossible. That's got all. You can go the other way too.
Okay, I got one. Alien World, easy. You can't mess it up.
Nope. That's why Destiny did what it did. That's why it is the way it is.
Except they didn't use alien worlds. They used known worlds.
But they made them alien worlds because of Space MacGuffin.
God.
These are really cool, too. If you ever use French curves, this thing has a whole set of French curves. You can, if I can remember how. There we go, resize.
French, easy.
Super easy. Yeah, I love this program. Mostly because it just all makes sense. Like, I would spend forever in Photoshop trying to find how to set up a basic function for something, and then watching tutorials, and it was a nightmare. This is the closest I've ever come to just, like, drawing. It's almost as good as working in my sketchbook. I think we're done.
I think we are.
Let's take one last look at our final product. I just got to remember where the hell I put it. Daily Doodles, there we go. Begin with a P. Yeah.
Looking good.
Nice. It's not the best cane in the world, but
it's a really good Gatling cane.
Yeah, it's the best Gatling cane you've ever damn seen. Cool. All right. Well, hopefully next time we will have the comments thing figured out so we don't have to use Twitter as some weird go-between. Or if we could just turn the chat on, that would be fine, right?
It is on, but only you and I can use it. I don't know.
Right. That's annoying.
Yeah. I'm sure it makes sense to some engineer at goddamn Google.
They should be called that. All right.
Get the hell out of here, and I will shut this thing down.
All right. Good night, everybody.
Thank you for joining us.
We will do this again, in a couple weeks? Is it once a month?
It's whenever we feel like it.
Okay. I thought there was like an actual specified.
Yes, but it is in effect whenever we feel like it.
Okay. Well, we'll do our best to stick to that schedule. Cool. All right. I am signing off. Good night, everybody.
Adios.